Good evening. A debate is about to begin among four of the Republican candidates for U.S. Senator in Nebraska. Sid Dinsdale, Bart McLeay, Shane Osborn, and Ben Sasse are part of the forum taking place at the Thompson Alumni Center off the campus of the, or on the campus rather, of the University of Nebraska, Omaha. There is a fifth candidate on the ballot, Clifton Johnson of Fort Calhoun. But the Nebraska Republican Party limited invitations to candidates who have spent or raised at least $5,000. The debate is scheduled to last 1 hour. The candidates will have opening and closing statements. And three panelists, including KETV NewsWatch 7's David Earle, will ask questions. So let's join the debate taking place right now at UNO.
Seeking your vote for the GOP nomination for U.S. Senate. My name's David Earle. I'm from KETV Channel 7 here in Omaha. I'll be moderating tonight. We are live streaming this on KETV.com right now for all the folks in the state and even outside the state, maybe, who want to watch the remarks tonight from these four gentlemen. I want to reintroduce the panelists here for you folks watching on KETV.com and then for you all in the room. Jim Rose is from KFAB Radio here in Omaha. He will be asking questions alongside Joe Jordan from Nebraska Watchdog. They'll be leading the questioning here at the Thompson Alumni Center tonight. Again, no applause for questions. We're going to save that until the very end. But we will applaud as the gentlemen come into the room. We want to begin with Bart McLeay. Bart. Also, Sid Dinsdale. And Ben Sasse. Last but certainly not least, Shane Osborn. In a very scientific way, we have drawn names out of a paper hat. Paper, their names are on paper. We've drawn them out of a hat for opening remarks. And we're going to begin with Mr. Dinsdale.
I'm running for the United States Senate because I see government intervention in all of our lives, and it's out of control. I have spent 37 years in community banking, serving businesses who want to expand or start, and helping people buy their first home. And I can tell you that government overreach is not good for Nebraskans. I'm from Palmer, Nebraska, a small town north of Grand Island. And excuse me if I'm a little distracted tonight, because my daughter Paige is going to have a baby tomorrow, a baby girl, her first one. And so we'll have another member of the sixth generation Dinsdale family in Nebraska. I know she'll be a diehard Husker fan. I'm running for the United States Senate because I see government overreach as a threat to our economy, our jobs, and to our children and grandchildren as they pursue the American dream. I'm sorry, what does that mean? Okay, all right. Obamacare is the most blatant government overreach that we have today. Obamacare is not an important first step in health care. We cannot fix Obamacare. It must be repealed. I've seen my business and other businesses across Nebraska have to deal with Obamacare, and Obamacare is bad for Nebraskans. I am proud to say that the majority of the support for my campaign comes from Nebraskans, and that's because I want to take more Nebraska to Washington, D.C. I do not want more Washington in Nebraska. Thank you very much.
Next opening remarks come from Mr. McLeay.
Thank you very much to the Republican Party and to their media partners. I'm delighted to be here in my hometown of Omaha with my family and friends. Thank you all for being here. My campaign has a single message. Freedom has worked. From the beginning of time, we've had multiple forms of government, but most of those have failed humanity in one form or another. But our system of governing, based in freedom, has worked. Our economic model, when it's allowed to operate in a free market system, has been a resounding success. I'm running for the United States Senate because I want to be the voice for freedom. I want to restore the law, the Constitution that protects our freedom. And I have a background in Nebraska to do just that. My family history goes back 150 years. And my wife Jane was a porter from Nebraska City who had the unique tradition of three generations who played Nebraska football. We have four children we raised in Omaha. We have deep roots in Nebraska. I've been a lawyer at QTAC Rock law firm here in Omaha for the past 29 years, and I've been involved in important issues for Nebraska. I fought the federal government up in Niobrara and won. I represented Nebraska as a special assistant attorney general on a water rights dispute. I've represented the privacy and contract interests of clients throughout Nebraska. I want to be your next United States Senator, and I will be your voice for freedom.
Next opening remarks come from Mr. Osborn.
Well, thank you. And thank you, Jim and Joe, for being here tonight, everybody else, the Nebraska GOP, and to my wife, Stacy, here for being here as well. This is an exciting evening to learn more about this race for U.S. Senate. I grew up in small town Nebraska, outside of Norfolk, raised by a single mom. She worked three jobs and taught me everything I needed to know about work ethic. She eventually ran the veterans home. And it's through those veterans that I learned the true meaning of service above self and wanted to serve. Went to University of Nebraska on an ROTC scholarship and got a degree in mathematics and headed off to the Navy for 9 years. I wore this nation's uniform, and I learned a lot. I grew up. I learned the meaning of leadership. And as a prisoner in China, I learned what my faith means to me. I learned what it's like to have the utmost pressure possible that you can imagine. Also in Afghanistan, flying combat missions, I learned what it's like to lead a team and accomplish a mission. Later, as your state treasurer, I kept my promises. I've cut budgets. I shrunk the budget nearly 12% in the treasurer's office. I reduced the staff by over a quarter. I brought transparency to Nebraskans. And as a small businessman, creating jobs as an entrepreneur, I know what it's like to sign the front of a paycheck and not just the back of a paycheck. I know what the federal government is doing firsthand to small businessmen and women. And I've traveled all over the state, over 40,000 miles, all 93 counties, and Nebraskans are united in their fear of the government involvement in their lives.
Mr. Sasse, your opening remarks.
Thank you, Jim, Joe, David, and the State Republican Party. It's great to be on the UNO campus. I've never run for anything before, so a lot of folks don't know me. My name is Ben Sasse, and I'm a fifth-generation Nebraskan. I grew up walking beans and detasseling corn every summer and selling pop at Husker football games every fall. Being raised in Nebraska is a great blessing, and I love the life that my wife Melissa and I have with our three kids being raised about a mile from where I grew up. I'm not a politician, and I'm not looking for a new job, but our culture in Washington, D.C. is broken. Our leaders are not honoring the Constitution. Our freedoms are eroding, and we have a moral obligation to leave this country as great and free and opportunity-filled for our kids and grandkids as we were blessed to inherit from our grandparents. Many of them fought wars to defend our freedom, and we owe a debt of gratitude to all of you who've worn the uniform for us. Our generation has a different task, but with the same goal. We must step up to defend freedom against runaway government, and that's why I'm running, to defend freedom for our children. Thank you for your time, and I look forward to discussing how we do that tonight.
All right, thank you, gentlemen. Our first question is going to come from Joe Jordan from Nebraska Watchdog.
Thank you very much. Gentlemen, you've all said that before this country can be ready for immigration reform, that the borders need to be secure. What's your definition of border security? And how many illegal crossings a year can you stomach? 50? 500? So what's your definition of border security by the numbers, and please be specific.
Our first answer from Sid.
Well, I say seal the border, Joe, you're right. So I did what I thought was smart, and I went down to the border in Arizona, Nogales, Arizona. And I drove down the border, and I saw the 18-foot-high fence that we have. And it stretched for about 3 miles, 4 miles each side of Nogales. But then there's a 300-yard gap. And I went and stuck my toe in Mexico and came back out with no passport. I'm not the most athletic guy. I didn't pole vault over this fence. It's a low fence. And that's just one gap of hundreds in the fence. So your point on putting a number on it, we can't even put a number on it, Joe. It was so disappointing. The federal government has let us all down. That's why we say you've got to seal the borders, because until you get those borders sealed, there's nothing to talk about, Joe. You ought to see this fence. Kiewit or Hawkins could go down there and finish this fence. The fence is tremendous, 2 million per mile, and then it goes down to a little X fence. You can just crawl right under it. So I say you can seal the border, and very few people would get over that fence once you finished it.
Mr. Osborn, your answer to that question.
Well, and I too agree we need to seal the border. It's a problem that we've faced for a long time when we tried comprehensive immigration reform and it didn't work. So we have the technology in place. It's quite simple. But we also know that Washington, D.C. can't agree on anything, right? It's dysfunctional out there. So what we need is to rely on the governors or the legislatures of the border states. Let them decide it. They might get to a conclusion. We have places where we can build fences, places where we can have virtual. But it's not just an illegal immigration problem. It's a national defense issue. When I talk to the special warriors I know, the Navy SEALs that are friends of mine, they tell me that's quite possibly the hottest, most dangerous place on earth is the Mexican border. Not Afghanistan, not Yemen, not, you know, all these other places that we read about in the paper. So that's a concern of mine, because it's only a matter of time before this comes across the border. And once we get those borders sealed, I think we all need to stand against amnesty. I oppose amnesty for illegal immigrants. We are a nation of laws.
Border crossings, Ben.
We have a fundamental duty at the federal government level to make sure that our borders are secure against enemies, foreign and domestic. That is exactly what the federal government exists to do. And we don't have any clarity about the numbers. Joe, I appreciate the specificity in your question. There are 19 different sectors of the Gulf Coast, of the Mexican border with Arizona, with Texas, with California, and the Canadian border. And the U.S. Customs and Border Patrol Service has no standardized metrics about how many crossings they allow per sector or how many they're trying to get to. There are not sector-specific goals. Fundamentally, I think this administration pays lip service to border security when really what they're most interested in is trying to figure out how to turn Texas into a blue or a purple state. You can't have any comprehensive immigration discussion with President You Can Keep Your Doctor Obama. He dissembles and deceives to try to get what he wants, and then he will selectively non-enforce certain pieces of the law. I would also fully oppose amnesty and a pathway to citizenship for those who came here illegally. We need border security that's measurable before any further conversations.
And Mr. McLeay, your answer to border security.
Thank you. There is no number that we can identify today, unfortunately. You know, right now there's net migration. I'm in favor of the triple-layered fence that they use in San Diego. That is effective. For uneven terrain across the other parts of the southern border, we can use sensor technology and even some unmanned non-military aircraft to help us seal the border. Right now, we need to, first of all, take control of the exiting of the United States. It's not just the entry that is the problem, but it's making sure that we're seeing people leave the country and come back. So we have to take control of the border. We have to secure our border first before we do anything else. I do agree with that. And it is the southern governors that I would turn to, and this is the reason. They have an interest in bringing people across for them for workers, but they also have an interest, they also have an equal interest to make sure they're not going to be paying for those people once they come across. So they have an interest going both ways. We'll get some workers, but we'll also make sure that we're following the law. I do not accept citizenship for people who have violated the criminal laws across our borders. I have identified a pathway for residency when those people, if there's no federal benefits and there's no voting rights under those circumstances. I am going to deal with the problem, however.
Gentlemen, if I could follow up, and I don't mean to be a pest, or maybe I do, but if you don't put a number on border security, you never get to immigration reform, because if someone says it's 50 a year or 500 crossings a year and you debate that, you can come up with an answer and say, okay, now the borders are secure, we've decided here's the number. Without that number, border security never happens and immigration reform never happens, correct?
I disagree with you. Go with me and look at the fence. If we put that fence in at 2 million per mile, nobody's getting in the United States unless they tunnel in. Nobody's getting in. It's 18 feet tall, 4x4s on an angle, filled with concrete, buried in the desert, with stuff on top so you can't climb, and bars across the bottom. You may get two or three people in there, across there somewhere, but Joe, that would seal the border.
Mr. Sasse, any specifics?
Yeah, I think we could use Israel as a proxy. This isn't rocket science. Other countries around the world do a much better job of securing their border than we do. And if we had an administration that at least used a proxy of other nations and where progress and success are made, we could be having a real conversation. Right now, this isn't a real conversation with this administration. They pay lip service to border security, and then they plan to not enforce the law.
And Mr. McLeay?
You know, I think I did answer it, albeit indirectly, and I admit that, Joe. The fact is that the governors on those borders have a direct interest in making sure that people come across that they want, but also that they don't have too many people illegal. So they have a direct interest. I wouldn't want someone telling the governor of Nebraska, Governor Hyman, things. I think we have to leave it to them to help us make that decision.
And Mr. Osborn, I think Joe Jordan's looking for a number.
You know what? One's too much if they have a weapon of mass destruction, right? One's too much. Are we going to sit back and cry and have the same exact thing that happened in 9/11 when we got lazy and sloppy, right? We need this border security. This, for me, isn't just about illegal immigration, and that is bad enough.
Our next question will come from Jim from KFAB.
Thank you. I think based on what we've heard so far tonight, Bo Pelini will be comforted by the fact that you're not going to downsize Husker football. Good evening, everybody, and thank you for your willingness to serve our state and nation in the United States Senate. The Federal Bureau of Labor Statistics projects that in the next 25 years, 125 million Americans will leave the full-time workforce to be replaced by just 50 million new workers. Given that Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security are funded through payroll taxes, these statistics present an ominous outlook for the funding of these programs. Each of you has promised an unwillingness to raise taxes as a means to fund these programs while advocating for a balanced federal budget. Given those positions, as a member of the United States Senate, what three specific policy components would you support to ensure financial solvency of these promised entitlements?
We'll begin with Mr. Sasse. Three specific components.
First of all, when you can't pay for the entitlement programs you have, you don't add new ones. So first and foremost, we need to repeal Obamacare and start over. Obamacare claims that they're going to spend about $2.6 trillion of new money. They've raised taxes to the tune of about $1 trillion. They're about $1.6 trillion short, and only in Washington, D.C. do you claim that math leads to a balanced budget. So first and foremost, we need to have a conversation about repealing Obamacare. Second, we need to look at the rest of our entitlement programs. Washington, D.C. loves to scream at each other about $14.3 trillion becoming $16 trillion, becoming $17 trillion, as if that's the real national debt story. Actually, we have between $72 and $75 trillion of unfunded obligations on the U.S. government's rolls. We just don't tell the truth about it because they don't keep honest books. So we need all entitlements to be discussed honestly. Third and finally, as we're nearly at time, discretionary non-defense programs need to be looked at as well. Energy, education, and the EPA are three agencies that are all too large, out of control, and too expensive.
Mr. Dinsdale, three specifics here on balancing the budget.
Well, I would hope I could find other United States senators who would want to sit in a room with me and talk about each department within the government, starting with retaining a very strong defense department, but it's a new world. I'm on the STRATCOM consultation committee. I was there when the sequester was underway. That is no way to run a railroad. So I would hope that we could look at the budget in its entirety after we agreed on a number for the defense department. But we do have to touch entitlements, Jim. And I would say promises made, promises kept for those above 50 years old or some number like that. But boy, if we don't do something with the entitlements for younger people, they're not going to be there anyway. So it could be some kind of means test, other details like that. But we are going to have to touch entitlements. But I think we've got so much fat in departments, like the education department. We have the first or second best public schools in the United States here in Nebraska, and yet we have an education department full of people making over $100,000 that never teach a kid how to spell or read. And we can do better without the education department. I think there is so much fat in the departments of government, we can cut a lot of waste out of that.
Mr. McLeay, three specific policy components for balancing the federal
budget. First of all, I want to do tax reform, both individual and corporate. On the individual side, a flat tax, two credits, three deductions that people know and like, the educational deduction, charitable deduction, and home mortgage interest deduction. We're going to do tax reform first. On the corporate side, 25% tax rate with accelerated depreciation. We're going to stimulate growth in this economy. Second, we're going to do a deficit reduction plan. I like Congressman Ryan's path for prosperity. Over 10 years, we're going to take $4.6 trillion over time to reach non-deficit spending. Here's the deal. You do tax reform, you have a deficit reduction plan, you are going to stimulate growth by business. That's going to raise income, raise tax revenue, and you're going to handle the deficit and the debt through the market. Let the market do the work for us. Further, we're going to keep our promises to seniors, all right. We're not going to change a thing for them. They can't turn around quick enough to make a change. But for everybody else, the young people growing up, my own kids, let's offer them an option of privatized accounts. Other countries have done this very successfully, and that's what I want to do. Multiple agencies, I hope I'll be able to tell you about it, EPA, energy, education, labor, health and human services, ought to go.
And Mr. Osborn.
Well, first I'd start with repealing Obamacare. It's something that I've been speaking out long before I was ever a candidate for Senate. Many of you saw me at the rallies across the state back in 2009 saying the exact same thing. It's going to result in government-run health care, and if you want to see how that works, go down to the local VA. It's the largest healthcare system in the country. It's completely government-run. We have veterans dying every single day because they can't get access to healthcare. We need a free market solution, individual healthcare plans with portability, cross-state lines from job to job, equal tax treatment, the ability to pool together and form. So that's the first. Second, we've got a balanced budget here in Nebraska, and it works really, really well for us. I've actually shrunk government. I know what it's like to make government more efficient. That's something we need in Washington, D.C. Every day, Nebraskans sit at the kitchen table and live within their budget. Is it too much to ask that the federal government does the same? That's the problem with Washington, D.C. We don't have enough people that will put the country first. Finally, the IRS. If you want a bipartisan solution, something you might actually get done with President Obama, simpler, fair, flat tax. It'll, just like Bart said, it will stimulate the economy, we'll get rid of those 100,000 IRS employees, and we'll do our taxes on the back of a postcard. Can you imagine the growth?
And Jim has a follow-up.
Each of you has advocated going through all of the other federal agencies other than these promised entitlements and defense. Are you prepared to say today, therefore, the Department of Agriculture and federal subsidies to Nebraska would be eliminated to balance the budget?
Mr. Sasse?
Yeah, we need a farm bill. As we got a new farm bill, and that's great for farmers who need farmers and ranchers that need crop insurance. But we need a farm bill over time that's sustainable, and a farm bill that's 80% food stamps is not sustainable. We need to get to a place where we're having a farm bill that's actually about farming.
Mr. McLeay.
You know, the crop insurance and the livestock disaster relief in that farm bill are excellent, and we need to keep that. We need to provide support. This is a matter of national security for me. However, there are places in that bill that need to be changed. You know, Congressman Fortenberry and Senator Grassley offered an alternative to keep that to a minimum, and it was thrown out. It was rejected. I disagree. We have to, even in our own farming communities, we have to put limitations.
And Mr. Osborn.
You know, traveling across the state to talking to ag producers, I mean, the key provisions for them in the farm bill are the crop insurance and the livestock insurance. That's what we need. We'll kill family farmers if we don't have that provision in place. The rest of it they're willing to talk about. I'm for splitting the farm bill. I think we should have split it. I think it makes sense to split that 80% food stamps out of there. You know what? There is waste in every aspect of government, including defense. But what they do in Washington, D.C. is they play games with the war fighters instead of looking at areas we could cut that wouldn't hurt the people and the men and women that are defending us the most.
And Mr. Dinsdale on the farm bill.
Yeah, a farmer in Aurora suggested to me that we do not need a farm bill that is collaborative on the social programs, food stamps. If we could get it simplified, as has been suggested, to cover the catastrophic events a farmer has to deal with, and thank goodness this farm bill is retroactive to northwest Nebraska and southwest South Dakota, but farmers are willing to take a farm bill a lot less complicated and go on their own.
Joe Jordan with our next question.
Thanks, David. Gentlemen, you've all said that you oppose raising the federal minimum wage because either it's bad for jobs or bad for business. If it's bad for jobs and it's bad for business to raise the federal minimum wage, by argument, it would be good for business and good for jobs to eliminate it. Would you eliminate the federal minimum wage if you could?
We'll begin with Bart.
You know, I have no problem eliminating the federal minimum wage. I think our Nebraska state will have a minimum wage, and I think others will as well. I don't know that we have to have the federal government involved in all of our business in every aspect of it, and this is one where it's not needed. You know, the minimum wage hurts poor people. Keep this in mind. If you are a young, unskilled worker, you've just been pushed out by this federal minimum wage. This is not about trying to help them. This is about hurting them and keeping them dependent. We have to change that. I'm against any action that's going to hurt middle class and lower income people. And the fact is, 80% of the economists will tell you it hurts them.
Mr. Sasse, would you eliminate the federal minimum wage?
I also would want to get more data to understand what economists would predict would happen. But fundamentally, I think it's probably the right choice. Here's why we don't want to raise the minimum wage. Raising the minimum wage does harm poor people. Right now, only about 11% of all the people that are on minimum wage are the primary wage earner in their house. 89% of the people who are on minimum wage are using it as a ladder and a rung of social mobility. And if you raise the minimum wage, you eliminate those transactions and those opportunities for those families to get to better jobs over time. The assumption would be there, Bart's number of 80% economists is right, those that assume that raising the minimum wage would harm a vast majority of poor people, I think the assumption is right that eliminating the minimum wage would be the right choice.
Mr. Osborn, your thoughts on the minimum wage?
Well, I think we should eliminate it and let the free market do what it does. I mean, you look at Nebraska, we've got a great problem. If you're a welder, go up to Columbus and name your price, right? We need to grow this economy instead of, you know, this raising of the minimum wage is ridiculous. The economists down in Texas A&M, 19,300 jobs in Nebraska eliminated. Why aren't we talking about growing jobs instead of going back to this divisive issue? Let's talk about North American energy independence, creating good jobs with people that gets them back into the workforce. We could create over 2 million jobs, the infrastructure in place. And oh, by the way, we wouldn't have to rely on these countries in the Middle East for their access to energy. Let's talk about growth, because that's really how we get out of the problems we're facing today.
Mr. Dinsdale, eliminating the federal minimum wage.
Jobs are a wonderful thing, and we have jobs available across Nebraska right now. Centralized planning has never worked. It never ceases to amaze me how people try to central plan. Look at the Soviet Union, look at China. It has never worked. A minimum wage doesn't work. In fact, it hurts the poor people. It's been mentioned a couple times. And thank goodness in Nebraska we have a low unemployment rate where the minimum wage doesn't really kick in. I think the minimum wage requirement would hurt the very people it's trying to support. So I'm not in favor of a minimum wage.
Jim, with our next question.
I'd like to press each of you again on this budget question, because poll after poll nationally says that Americans don't believe things that come out of their elected representatives' mouths when it comes to balancing the budget. Each of you has signed on to the No Tax Pledge, which obligates, quote, you to oppose any and all efforts to increase the marginal income tax rates for individuals and or businesses, and oppose any net reduction or elimination of deductions and credits unless matched dollar for dollar by further reducing tax rates. And I'd like to press each of you on this. In fiscal 2013, 71% of the entire federal budget was spent on Medicare, Social Security, defense, and the federal portion of Medicaid, the cost of which is shared with the states. Nebraskans, if Nebraskans are to believe their next U.S. senator, please outline for us tonight to what degree you would downsize these massive departments so as to balance the federal budget. And before each of you trots out the Departments of Commerce, Energy, Education, and Housing and Urban Development, the eliminations of which is a traditional campaign season talking point for Republicans, those departments accounted for $108 billion out of a $3.7 trillion budget.
We'll begin with Mr. Sasse.
Yeah, first off, we don't have a revenue problem. We have a spending problem. That's why I signed the No New Taxes Pledge, because fundamentally Washington likes to deceive people and pretend that the solutions are somehow that Washington isn't big enough. Look at what President Obama has been talking about since he rolled out his budget last month. He said that we need to end the age of austerity. I honestly have no idea what he's talking about. I believe the president must understand math, but here's the reality. Under his watch, we have grown the federal debt $6 trillion in his just over 5 years in office, and he calls it the age of austerity. This man's language is so routinely so far removed from the truth that it leads to cynicism in the public. The age of austerity? Barack Obama is the Kim Kardashian of government excess. We need to have a conversation about the real problem, and it is overpromised spending. It is not insufficient taxation.
Mr. Dinsdale on the No New Taxes Pledge.
Yeah. Jim, I signed that too because I think we have plenty of federal tax revenue. It's a little over $200 billion a month. I think that ought to be enough for the United States of America. But you're right, you've got to touch entitlements, and I go back to entitlements. And there's going to be some tough decisions we need to make, and we're going to have to make those changes in order to make any significant change in the deficit. But I also would say, if you would get this federal government out of our way, this is a wonderful time to be an American. We could grow this economy, we could boom again, become energy independent, free up our businesses to grow, add employees, get these regulations out of the way, stand down EPA, stand down OSHA. It would be amazing what we could do as a country if the federal government would get out of the way. And that's what Reagan did back in those years. And he actually cut taxes and the economy grew and more revenue came into the Treasury. So I know it looks terrible and it is terrible, but I'm here to tell you as a country, we can do it if we get the centralized government overreach out of our way.
Mr. McLeay.
Thank you. You know, we didn't get into this problem overnight. This took a long period of time. It's going to take a long period of time for us to get out. We can't plan a solution that's just going to be in the next couple of years. We've got to have something that's going to go over a period of time. I talked earlier about tax reform, reducing the rates on individual taxes to people, reducing corporate taxes, and giving accelerated appreciation. Why? Because I am a firm believer of the market. The market works. And if we allow it to work, we're going to have an economic explosion that will take care of much of that debt, much of the deficits, and on to the debt. I believe we are going to have some reforms. I mentioned it earlier. I'm not afraid to say it. 50, you know, those people who are in retirement or getting close to retirement, they're safe. We can't touch them. They can't turn it around fast enough. I can't say that or stress that enough. However, our children, my children, let's offer them alternatives. I predict, as it happened in Chile, that they'll turn to private accounts. They'll reject the government. And that's what could happen here. We will take care of this problem over time with specific solutions.
Mr. Osborn?
Well, I think actions speak louder than words. You know, as a state treasurer, I didn't just balance a budget, I cut it. I've actually done that. I think the way to really get Washington and held them accountable, not just to balance budget amendment that I've talked about, transparency. Follow the money, you'll find the root of the evil. That's the way we're going to have to get things in order and hold our elected officials accountable. There's waste in every aspect of government, including defense. And this is coming from a veteran, right? Yes, we have to protect the warfighters, but a lot of the rear echelon support stuff, that can be outsourced. We can have big savings there. Secondly, we can't move the goalposts, just like the government does every day on through regulators overreaching. We can't move the goalposts on our seniors or people approaching retirement age. Fraud is rampant in these systems. We need to crack down on fraud, but we also need to have an all of the above solutions, at least all on the table. If anybody says you're just going to have the conservative way and we're going to get entitlement reform, you're being ridiculous. Yes, we need control of the Senate back, but that's 51-52. That's not to 60. So we're going to have everything on board. That's the 800-pound gorilla, and if we don't face it now, we're going to leave a country worse off to the next generation for the first time in America's history, and I refuse to be part of that.
Jim has a follow-up.
So each of you essentially is saying the way to fix it is to grow the economy. And are you willing to say here today, despite this pledge, that under no circumstances would you ever vote for a tax increase or a benefits cut, a real benefits cut, in any of those of the 71% programs to assist in balancing the budget?
Sid.
Well, that pledge means that I'm not going to vote for something that's net new tax revenue. So I would stand by that. Yes, I would. The government's taken in plenty of revenue. We have to grow the economy, which we can do. It is just nonsensical to me that we have this centralized planning going on over and over, and they want to take more of our money, but they won't free us of those regulations and let us grow.
No new revenue, Ben?
Yeah, you asked a two-part question, and definitely no new revenue, net revenue, because obviously we don't fundamentally have a revenue problem. We have a spending problem. But the second half of your question said something about no benefit cuts at all. I do think for people my age and younger, we need to have an honest conversation about the fact that Washington thinks they're an eternal Santa Claus, and they promise things that don't add up. Those at or near the retirement age need to be protected, but there need to be benefit adjustments for people my age and younger, for sure.
Bart.
I don't see any need for raising taxes. I truly don't. I understand that it's hard to see because we have a $17 trillion debt and we had $500 billion in deficit spending. I see the picture clearly, but I also believe that over time the market will solve this problem for us, and I think we need to look to that. And as I mentioned earlier, we can privatize accounts. We can take other actions too. If people are earning millions of dollars, young people are earning millions of dollars at the time of retirement, we may have to make adjustments in means testing for someone like that. But that's an exception. We made promises to seniors and those reaching retirement, and I'm not going to be a part of breaking that, and I don't see the need to raise taxes.
Shane, do you grow the way out of the problem?
Well, we do. No new taxes, no tax increases. How could we possibly trust President Obama and say, hey, if we're going to start to pay some of this down, you'll use it appropriately? That's not what he does. He'll take from a defense budget and give it to somebody else that did a favor for him or helped get him elected. So I absolutely disagree with that. 1% increase in GDP growth wipes out $4 trillion in debt over 10 years. That's how you get it done.
Joe Jordan with our next question.
Thanks, David. Well, in an attempt to get more specific on this specific issue of taxes and spending, the past two wars this country fought, we paid for on a credit card. Since we are asking the men and women of the armed forces to potentially pay for these wars with their lives, shouldn't American taxpayers be willing to put up something out of their pocketbooks to pay for these wars? Would you in favor, would you be in favor, given the possibility of a war at some point, whether it's this administration or the next or whenever, would you favor a war tax?
We'll begin with Mr. Osborn.
No, I wouldn't favor a war tax. How about we live within our means? And when this happens, we make sacrifices. That's the problem. Never have so few served. When I served, it's less than 1% that are out there defending us every single day. And so we have this small percentage of the population that's underrepresented in the Congress. We're down to 2, maybe 3 combat veterans in the entire United States Senate. You wonder why we're having the problems here today? The lowest level of veterans serving in the country. We need more people that will put the country first, that'll build up a strong enough military so we don't get into these wars in the first place. I believe in peace through strength. And right now what we have is we've got even Republicans attacking veterans because there's no representation out there. That Ryan budget, what did it do? It kicked the can down the road for another 10, 20 years. Doesn't do anything to rein in spending, but what it does do is take something out of the veterans and the retirees. Recently, the cuts, I disagree very much so with the cuts that pre-World War II Army levels. Is the world safer right now? Do we really need to be cutting the warfighters? How about we start to pick priorities and realize we all came together as United States to provide for a common defense? That is the number one priority of the federal government.
Mr. McLeay, your thoughts on a war tax?
I'd be opposed to a war tax, certainly hypothetically. I mean, I don't see any reason for it at this point. We have a strong defense. We need to support our military a little bit more than we have, actually. We have massive overspending. We have a government that's an albatross around our neck. We have Obamacare that's spending $1 trillion, and for what? What are we seeing? We haven't even seen a program put together yet. That machine hasn't run, and when it does run, it's going to flop. So we have too many accounts, EPA, Department of Energy. We have so many places where we can cut that we can find some funds if we find ourselves in a war. I'm not going to stand here and tell the American people that I'm going to now in advance tell them we're going to have a new tax on them for a war that is hypothetical. And I can't even imagine doing it if it was real.
Paying for a future war, Mr. Dinsdale.
No, I see no reason to have a war tax. I'd be opposed to war tax. Again, I go back to the overreach of the federal government into our pockets. And I want to control my own money. I think Nebraskans do, too. I'm just sick and tired of Washington, D.C. taking more of my money and doing with whatever they want. It's irresponsible. And no, I would not be in favor of any more taxes.
Mr. Sasse.
We don't need a war tax. Let's put this in context. There are 3 kinds of federal spending. There are entitlement spending, there's defense spending, and there's non-defense discretionary spending. When JFK was president, 52% of our federal budget was spent on defense, 1% on health entitlements, a 50-to-1 ratio. By the time that Reagan was president, defense had declined to 30%, and health entitlements had risen to 11. So we were at a 3-to-1 ratio of defense to health entitlements. As of about 2 years ago, health entitlements now outdistance defense spending 24-to-22. And when you look at federal government projections for the year 2030, it's going to be about 71% entitlement programs, less than 14% defense. This is the first and fundamental duty of the federal government. I've got little kids, our 12 and 10-year-old girls. We teach them in the Constitution that the government is the army. It's a military, and we also have some social safety net programs. If you look at our budget now, the U.S. government is becoming just a big insurance company that happens to own a little Navy. This is not the picture of the country that the Constitution and our founders envisioned.
I think Joe's going to press you here.
Well, I think I know where this is going, but Mr. Osborn, you specifically said about sacrifice. We know the men and women in the armed forces are making a sacrifice, but if the taxpayers don't feel some pinch here in these wars, what prevents the administrations, whomever they are, from upping another one?
Well, first and foremost, what I talked about earlier, a balanced budget amendment, right? So let's live within that. So what I'm talking about is the rest of us making sacrifices, maybe losing some services if we're in a long, expensive war. Remember World War II? It worked, right? We saw prosperity after it. The war is a horrible thing. We don't want to see war, but at the same time, providing for a war tax, I just don't see that as a good solution.
Mr. Dinsdale.
I agree. I don't want any more taxes. It's craziness. They take in over $200 billion a month, and that's enough.
Mr. Sasse.
Madison said, the guardian of our liberty is the watchfulness of the citizenry. The reason you don't have too many wars is because we need an engaged republic. We need an engaged citizenry. We have a crisis in the country. We're not passing on the meaning of America to our kids. We need to have more deliberate conversations about what it takes to pass on the meaning of America. You don't do that with sin taxes about wars. War, defense is the fundamental duty of government. The public needs to be engaged there.
Mr. McLeay.
You know, I don't see an increase in a war or adopting a war tax for really any reason at this point. You know, we have, I support a balanced budget amendment. In that balanced budget amendment, there is an exception for time of war. And so there could be a possibility someday in the future where you'd have to make an exception to the balanced budget amendment. But at present, I don't see no reason for it.
All right, we'll move on to our next question. Jim.
Through speeches and campaign literature, each of you has advocated for the repeal of most of, if not all of the parts of the President's Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act. We know it as Obamacare. If I were one of the 140,000 Nebraskans who prior to its passage were without health insurance coverage or denied it because of a pre-existing condition, what would you say to me tonight?
We'll begin with Mr. Sasse.
First, the Patients Protection and Affordable Care Act. Talk about another Washington euphemism that has no, it's just completely detached from reality. We have a system of health care in this country that is absolutely in crisis. Right now, Obamacare is the number one driver of growing uninsurance in America. The administration makes up numbers somewhere between 1.5 and 4.5 million newly insured, but about 6 million people have lost their insurance because of Obamacare since October. But Republicans make a mistake if we can act like, though we must be for the full repeal of Obamacare, there's no room for any dispute about that question, but we make a mistake if we act like the healthcare sector pre-2008 worked well. Healthcare was a mess before 2008 as well, but it wasn't because we had too little government, but because we already had too much that didn't enable people to have a portable health insurance policy that went with them across job and geographic changes. These kinds of solutions for the poorest and sickest among us are best delivered in Lincoln, not in Washington, D.C. Washington, D.C., one-size-fits-all solutions from D.C. don't work.
Our next answer from Sid.
Yeah. I would say the other 1.7 million of Nebraskans who had health care are also impacted by Obamacare. It's another government overreach, and it was sold on the basis that people didn't have access to health care, which is just a lie. I've served on the Methodist Health System Board and still do. I can tell you we give access to everybody for health care. Not everybody comes through the front door. Some of them come through the back door. The problem with health care has been, since it was started in the 60s, the cost of health care. We need market forces in health care. We can do much better than Obamacare. And what the heck is Obamacare anyway? He's changed it 29 or 30 times politically so that he can postpone the consequences and win another election in November. So I would tell those people, you've always had access, and we're still going to give you access, but we've got to do it differently because cost is the issue. This Obamacare thing is going to break us. It's taking money from Medicare to fund it, going to cut back on Medicare benefits because of that funding, so it's got to be repealed.
Bart, the question is, what would you say to one of the 140,000 Nebraskans who gained health care under Obamacare?
I tell them, just give me a couple of months. I'm going to get in the U.S. Senate, and I'm going to answer your prayers, because here's what we're going to do. We're going to repeal Obamacare right now, but we're going to put in a solution. We're going to give refundable tax credits to people who are poor and need them, deductions for other people. There is a specific proposal, H.R. 2300, in the Congress right now by a doctor, Representative Price, and this is some of the provisions that he has. It allows individuals and small businesses to come together, form associations to sell insurance, drive down costs. It allows insurance to be sold across state lines. I would add private exchanges to that so we have regional sales. It brings down costs. You have best practice defense given to physicians so that when they're caught in that position of do I give them more tests or not, they know they're safe and don't have to. Brings down costs. The things like portability of insurance would be permitted. And in terms of pre-existing illnesses, we have pooling right now on the state level. I don't mind doing something on a federal level to put that together, but here's the answer. I'm going to allow you and the people here to keep your doctor. I'm going to allow you to keep your insurance policy. I'm not going to force mandates down you on anybody, but the bottom line is the free market system will be great for those individuals.
And Shane.
I agree with Bart on it. You know, in a horrible bill that I was the lone person standing up here back in 09, speaking out against this before it got passed, trying to keep it from getting passed, trying to convince Senator Nelson to do the right thing, and unfortunately we failed. But I think the worst part of this is this individual mandate. I don't care whether it's Obamacare or Romneycare, it doesn't work. And that's the worst part of a horrible bill. What we've done is taken a bad health care system and made it worse, all in the spirit of helping that 1% that are uninsurable, right? We can do block grants to the states. High-risk pools work. That's what we need. These people need to realize that they're going to have their own individual health care plan. Even if they're getting assistance to pay for it, then they'll take ownership. Then the free market kicks in. Then you start driving down health care costs. And another thing that we need is major tort reform in the health care system and across America. I'm tired of the frivolous lawsuits tying up businesses year after year and for doctors having to price this into every single thing they do.
Our next question from Joe Jordan.
Gentlemen, in a couple of months, voters are going to decide which of the four of you they want to nominate for this bid for the United States Senate. Arguably, for the last several months, you've all been running hard campaigns, know each other pretty well. If you weren't in this race, which of the other three would you vote for?
Is that the best question of the night? Let's start with Sid.
Joe.
Yes.
I think these three men are all good men. I've seen them on the campaign trail a lot. They're working very hard. I'm a different man than they are. I'm 61 years old. I've had a full career. I'm going to have self-term limits. I've never been in government. I'm not an attorney. So I think any one of the three of them would serve well, but not quite as good as me, Joe.
And Shane, who would you vote for if not for yourself?
Well, I tell you what, I will do is pledge to support whoever wins this primary and make sure they're our next United States Senator. We have to come together when this is all done. We're getting to know each other pretty well, and we get along pretty well out on the trail, and things are going to heat up in the last 60 days. But at the end of the day, I think what I have to offer isn't up here on the stage other than myself, somebody who's put the country first, proven through leadership, proven they can shrink budgets, knows what it's like to be an entrepreneur and create jobs from scratch and look your bride in the eye and say, honey, I'm quitting a great job at Silverstone where I loved it, and I'm going to go out on my own and start something new from scratch. You're trying to act like you're all strong and ready to go, and inside you're scared out of your mind. And so that's what I think I bring to the table that maybe my three friends up here don't.
That was not an endorsement, Ben.
So since two people before me ducked, I'm only going to give you half a duck, Joe. I do think Nebraska is blessed with some good choices. I don't think it's good enough, frankly, just to be a vote. The fact that we have a crisis in Washington isn't just because the Democrats are in charge. We have a crisis in Washington because the Republicans aren't succeeding at telling the story of the meaning of America to our kids. When President Obama says, you didn't build that, right now, a lot of 18 to 22-year-old kids think that that's mostly true. And they think if you've got something, you must have taken it from someone else. And we need to do better. We need to actually not just have a vote, we need to have a voice. But I'll tell you what, my 10-year-old daughter has already answered this question at our house. And Sid wins. We were driving somewhere the other day, and she said, Dad, if I were 18, I'm not really sure. I like Sid a lot. Bart.
Ben, the only thing that proves is that your daughter knows how to read financial statements. I look at it this way. I think I've got a guy who's perfect for the Department of Veteran Affairs, the next health care czar, and Department of Banking, and that leaves by default, Joe, it's me. So I have a tough time, but I will say this, these are fine people. We have gotten to know each other across the trail, and it has been a lot of fun. And we're going to have a great Republican Senate nominee, I can promise you that. You know, my background and experience, you know, has been in business as a business attorney for 29 years, and I've been blessed to have a great practice. I've learned a lot in it. I was an accounting major. I feel I can handle the economic principles that drive businesses to grow and the economy to expand. I've also been an advocate. You know, we were talking about the divisiveness and gridlock in Congress. I've been there. I've been in every form of dispute resolution you can imagine, and I'd like to believe pretty effective. So there's my answer.
Jim, can you get us back on track here?
So I guess in the Douglas County straw poll, it's Sid won, everybody else zero. But I think the rest
thanks for coming.
But I think the rest of the campaigns may mount a challenge to the election commissioner's office since she's not 18.
Hey, it's Dodge County, actually. I'm the only guy playing an away game tonight. I'm the only non-Omahan on the stage.
It's time to go easy on you guys now. Would you vote today for NATO military action against Russia's invasion of the Ukraine, since it is the Senate's responsibility and the Congress's responsibility to vote in favor of going to war? And if not, how is your position different from the President's? We'll begin with Mr. McLeay.
Thank you very much. You know, I'm going to start with this. I'm going to answer the question directly, but I'm going to start with this. Our President has done a poor job in foreign policy. He started with a speech in Cairo in 2009 where he apologized for the United States' action. He led from behind in Libya. The only superpower in the world never leads from behind. We are in this position because of our current president and his foreign policy. Now let me answer the question. In Ukraine, this is what I would do. I would have economic sanctions imposed immediately. I would freeze the assets of the czars and oligarchs that are supporting Russia. I would impose diplomatic isolation immediately. I would begin process of removing him from the G8, and I would also take steps to set up the missile defense in Poland. We need to take active, forceful steps toward Putin. I don't agree with our president, but I don't like anybody like Putin pushing the United States around at all. So I would take very aggressive action, but I'm not prepared to take military action because I don't think it's necessary at this point.
Mr. Sasse?
Yeah, we need to start by asking how we got to the position we're in right now. We are in this position because Barack Obama has a naive liberal worldview that says that somehow aggression is out of date on the international stage, and we're being schooled on the international stage by Iran, by Putin, by North Korea. We again and again are being humiliated on the international stage by the worldview of a president who's trying to become the Jimmy Carter of the 21st century. We fundamentally need to honor the commitments and the pledges we've made to deploy anti-ballistic missile systems in Poland and the Czech Republic. We're in the circumstance we're in right now, and it doesn't have an easy out. We're in this circumstance because President Obama signaled to the world that if he got through an election, he would have more flexibility. We have been appeasing Putin, and we are now having these things come home to roost because we have a president who doesn't understand that the world is a dangerous place.
Authorizing NATO retaliation on Russia, Mr. Osborn.
You know, not at this time. We don't have the forces. I'm sorry to break it to you, folks. Readiness is at an all-time low right now. We're not ready. We can't go in. Our men and women have been chewed up, 3, 4, 5 deployments. We can't do it. Secondly, stepping back and agreeing with the folks up here, we've got a leadership problem. We've got the worst foreign policy since Jimmy Carter. It's made us look weak. I have literally collected intelligence off of every single country we're talking about here today that we're having problems with. And what happens is this. In the Middle East, they don't respect freedom like we do. They don't respect life like we do, but they do respect strength and power. When you cross a line in Syria and let them get away with it, that has more effects than just in Syria. It goes over to Iran. Iran is developing uranium. They're going to have a weapon soon. They know they're 6 months away, so what do? Kick the can down the road with this bogus agreement that does nothing to stop uranium enrichment. Then you go over to China, Afghanistan. You're seeing the problems heating up over there. Now we've got a country that's invaded a sovereign nation, and we don't have the ability to do it. We don't have a president that can lead on it. This is a crisis. This is going to hurt us for decades to come. Peace through strength has worked. Why would we want to abandon it? We're going to be repairing this for the next 2 to 3 generations.
Mr. Dinsdale.
Yeah, our president has led us down this path by his actions or inactions in Benghazi, Egypt, Syria, the line that meant nothing, and so here we are. And it's particularly difficult militarily. I don't think we have much of a choice to do anything militarily, but there's other problems like Gazprom, the huge energy company in Russia that heats all the homes in Eastern Europe. So our European allies are pretty well neutered. We're in a tough spot here, and we got here because we don't have a president that understands that there are bad people out there, and you don't lead from behind. You don't go around on some kind of a rock tour telling everybody how great you are. You lead with strength, like Reagan, peace through strength. He won the Cold War without ever firing a shot. We've got to get back to leadership. That's what this election's about. And I think that's what all of us want to see is leadership in Washington, D.C., to do the right things, be honest with the American people. We have a real crisis in America on the foreign policy side because we have a community organizer up against the former head of the KGB, and you know who's winning.
Jim, do you have a follow-up?
No.
Joe.
Earlier we talked about federal agencies and departments and what have you, and there's always this move to try to get candidates to name 3 agencies they get rid of. I just want one. One agency, your top priority to eliminate if you could.
We'll go with Mr. McLeay.
Department of Education immediately. There's no need for it. It doesn't serve any purpose. I object to Common Core. I think we'd have a huge saving immediately from that agency. We don't have it here. We don't need it anywhere else. We can set up the information for an information booth so that any state could go to an information booth and find out what's going on in another state if they need to know. It is an unnecessary agency, but there's plenty more. The EPA needs to be downsized immediately. I've told our farmers and ranchers across this state that I am going to stop the war on agriculture by the EPA and OSHA. They have invaded our farms and our ranches in unprecedented ways. The EPA needs to redefine the word, our Congress, and I will do it as your senator, I will redefine the word wetlands in the Clean Water Act, because that has been a big problem in this country. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take specific legislative actions against the EPA and against OSHA. I'm going to redefine what a grain facility is so we don't have OSHA coming on small family farms against the law. And I'm going to take yet other actions. I'm going to go to the Administrative Procedures Act, and I'm going to change that law so that when it's citizen versus government, it's not government wins unless citizen proves they did something right. It's the other way around.
Mr. Dinsdale.
Well, I mentioned earlier the Education Department. Of course, that's what Bart said. But I would also take a strong look at the Energy Department. I want to just mention that a little bit. Everybody in this room knows that the low-hanging fruit in government to really make a difference is energy independence. And look at what our federal government is doing, putting up roadblock after roadblock, obstacle after obstacle. I think the rest of the world is sitting around going, look at America, low sulfur, high quality coal, more natural gas they know how to use, petroleum everywhere. They won't build a refinery. They won't build a pipeline. They want to talk about a carbon tax, our people in Washington. That's what I'm running on. Less Washington, D.C., more Nebraska common sense. For heaven's sakes, United States of America. And you talk about budget stuff, Jim, just think what we could do if we were energy independent. The jobs we could create, initially there's a ton of jobs on the pipeline, for example, but look at the grid we've got, the power grid. There is so much opportunity in the United States if we would just free up Americans, free up Nebraskans to use their risk-taking, use their capital, and we would just be amazed at what we would do.
Mr. Osborn.
Well, first and foremost, the biggest impact to the economy is that one agency that I don't care which political party you're in, you fear the most, and that's the IRS. You get a letter from the IRS, your heart drops. 100,000-plus employees, all with the power of God. That's something we can do with a simplified, fair, flat tax code, right? The economy will take off. We do our taxes on the back of a postcard and don't have to hire somebody for 6-7 months to get our tax returns done and live in fear every day. That's the first and foremost. Second, Department of Education. I, too, oppose Common Core. This is all centralized planning. This is a one-size-fits-all education system that's really geared towards major metropolitan areas and doesn't take into account the diverse population that we have here in Nebraska, and it's killing the youth of our future. We need to educate. And finally, there's one thing I've learned traveling around this state, all 40,000 miles, is that the regulators, including the EPA and OSHA, are really hurting us the most. The war on coal, 70% of our power in Nebraska comes from coal. We need cheap power and infrastructure, and then we'll bring those jobs back from overseas and get this economy going again.
Mr. Sasse, one department in the federal government to eliminate.
Yeah, I'll give you more than that. We need to reverse this conversation. Instead of working down from what exists, we need to work up from a constitution. We need a constitutional recovery in this country, and the four departments that are mentioned in the Constitution are defense, state, Treasury and Justice, and every other agency should need to have a compelling reason for it to continue. So I think, as many of the gentlemen have mentioned up here, most of the EPA's function should be done at the state and local level. Commerce, you already took off the table, Joe, but we can go ahead and take commerce off the table. Energy is a department that is a huge bureaucracy, more than 100,000 employees and contractors now, but without a strategy. The president is trying to declare a religious war against energy production in this country. We need a strategy, but not a bureaucracy. He always prefers to build bureaucracies without a strategy. And education, almost every function being done in the Federal Department of Education has no constitutional warrant. The Common Core is atrocious. It was, of course, promised to be a voluntary system. They're already hooking federal monies to it. It's going to be a war for political corruptness from Washington, D.C. We need to oppose Common Core.
Our final question of the night will come from Jim.
Thank you, David. And a question for each of you about life in the United States. In 1965, just prior to the passage of President Johnson's package of domestic spending initiatives known as the Great Society and nicknamed the War on Poverty, one out of every four black Americans were born into a single-parent home. Nearly 50 years later, three out of every four black Americans is born into a single-parent home. Many conservative voices blame this massive federal program for the dismantling of the American family and a staggering increase in government dependence, crime, teen pregnancies, and unemployment, especially in the minority communities. Would you agree and therefore work to defund these entitlements? Or if not, what policies would you advocate in the U.S. Senate to reverse this troubling societal trend?
We'll begin with Mr. Sasse.
Yeah, the war on poverty has been an abject failure. When the war started in 1964-65, 15% of Americans lived in poverty. Today, the same percentage of folks live in poverty. We've spent $21 trillion, and we spend 16 times as much on an annual basis for federal anti-poverty programs, and the only output we've gotten from it is that the federal government now subsidizes the breakdown of the nuclear family and the absence of dad. You're right, it's worse in the minority communities, but it's true across all racial groups now. When the war on poverty started, 93% of kids lived in a house where dad was present. It's now fallen below 60% overall, but it's only 40% of babies born to women under the age of 30 right now. These programs aren't just economically unsustainable, they're hateful. They are doing things to destroy the family. The 9th and 10th Amendment would say we devolve these programs back to the state and local level. Vermont and Nebraska don't have the same populations, we don't have the same problems, and we don't have the same values. We have a lot more confidence in Governor Heineman and the unicameral to address these issues than Harry Reid and Barack Obama.
Sid.
I believe local is better in all cases. And of course, we all know right here in our great city, we have our own problems in this particular area. But jobs are such a good thing in so many ways. My wife and I have been involved in work in several different organizations trying to help our problem that we have here. But I would bring it down to local, fund the local government, see what we can do, get training going. But the continued entitlements just perpetuates this thing. A person the other day suggested that maybe entitlements are on a declining scale. Maybe unemployment benefits are on a declining scale. Because right now, for example, for someone to get off unemployment, there isn't a heck of a lot of incentive in some cases. We also have some poverty programs that perpetuate the problem. When a young single mother tries to get a job, she immediately is disqualified from food stamps and other aid. So we've got some things that we could do better, but I think the place to start would be to have local resources, employ means to take care of this problem, to work on the problem. We know it's a huge challenge, and we've got a long ways to go.
Mr. McLeay, the war on poverty.
You know, we lost the war on poverty. But here's the problem. Republicans' messaging needs to change. You know, we've talked a lot of time. I hear people say that people on food stamps or subsidized housing, they're lazy or a drag on society. That's not the message we need to send. What we need to tell those people, look them in the eye and tell them that those people on food stamps or subsidized housing, look, you're under the thumb of the government. You've lost your freedom. We want to help you. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to create jobs and an environment of opportunity for you and your family so that you can stand with dignity and respect one day and say, we don't need them anymore, referring to the government and those programs. Yes, we have to do this slowly. It's not going to happen overnight. We can't turn this around immediately, but we can change attitudes. We can remind people of the beauty of freedom, the dignity of it, and the wonders that can provide for them and their families. That's where I want to go. I want to talk about that to all people. I have crisscrossed this state multiple times now, but I've spent my share of time not only in Scottsbluff and Grand Island, but in North Omaha as well. And what they tell me is the same thing across the state. They want jobs, opportunity, and independence.
Shane.
Well, you know, I was raised by a single mom, my sister and I were, and you grow up swearing that's never going to happen to me. And then here I was, a single dad while I was treasurer, with sole custody of three kids, one in diaper and my ex-wife's son, who I've adopted, and with my wife Stacy in my life for the last 2.5 years, it's never been better. So I'm living proof that I know that two parents are better, and it really helps the kids grow up in a healthier situation. Even though I turned out all right, I like to think. But there's something that goes on with the federal government. It's called unintended consequences. You have all these people that tell us things that sound really good, and then there's these unintended consequences, and they backfire. Guess what? If you incentivize people not to work, why should we be shocked when they don't work, right? If you're going to tell people, and I've spoken with Ernie Goss, the economist from Creighton, it's equivalent on being on full aid, $12.50 an hour. But if somebody takes an $8.50 job, they're going to give that $4 up because it's an all or nothing system. Why wouldn't we make up the delta for those single parents so they can get back into the workforce and work from that $8.50 up to $9.10? At the end of the day, you grow this economy, you'll create the right paying jobs, and then get people with skin in the game, starting to pay taxes and getting involved. They'll be worried about what their government's doing to them once they're paying taxes.
All right, gentlemen, we are 1 minute over. Thankfully, there are no commercial breaks online. So we're going to begin closing remarks right now. Again, we drew these names randomly. And Bart, the first closing remarks.
Thank you very much. It has been a pleasure to be here. Again, thank you to the panel for great questions and the opportunity. You know, I said at the outset, my message is simple and it's a single message. Freedom has worked. I've been the voice of freedom and justice for the past 30 years in my job. I understand the tough, complex financial issues that need to take place in Washington. I've done that. I've been there. I also understand the legal and constitutional ones. We have a government that's run amok. We have the IRS targeting political groups, the Department of Justice wiretapping the Associated Press. We have the EPA doing unlawful flyovers of our farmers. We have the NSA sweeping up millions upon millions of records and in violation of law by misrepresenting to the court there. We have the Home and Health and Human Services through Obamacare violating our religious freedoms. I understand these issues. I will not be fooled or pushed around on legal or constitutional issues. I will be your freedom fighter. I want to go to Washington. I ask for your vote. I ask for your support. Please join me. Jump on the freedom train. We're heading to Washington. We're roaring in there. We're going to remind them that freedom has worked. Thank you.
Closing remarks from Ben.
Campaigning is new to me, but I've been traveling across the state trying to sound a clarion call that America doesn't have much time. Let's be clear. We're still great, and our greatest days should lie in front of us, but for the first time in generations, our people are worried about the future. Obamacare is only one of the many reasons why. My family and I are traveling the state in a campaign Winnebago, and we're having a great experience. We're encouraged by the resilience of our people. But I've got three little kids, so I try to keep my coat hanging high, and I try not to sit in anything sticky. And so the other day, we were pulling up at a campaign stop, and as we approached, I had tightened my tie and put on my jacket, and I was just about to head out of the bus onto a speaking event, and all of a sudden, my two-year-old boy, Breck, had a face that went totally green. And then came the hurl worthy of a Halloween movie. Melissa said to me, "How long till you speak?" I said, 12 minutes, and she said, "Good, that's all you." So as I'm crouching down, and I'm trying to tuck my tie into the buttons of my shirt, and I'm holding Breck back with one hand, and I'm trying to clean up the floor with the other, it dawned on me. I'm not sometimes a dad and sometimes running for office. I'm running for office because I'm a dad. The greatness of the country our mothers and fathers gave to us won't be here for our children if we, the people, don't pull together and put things right. I'm asking you for your vote so that together we can preserve freedom for our kids. Thank you for your time tonight.
Shane, closing remarks.
Well, first, thank you everybody for coming and getting involved. It's really great to have this audience out here. You know, people say, Shane, why do you want to go get involved out in Washington, D.C. in that mess? And it goes back to a saying that I learned in the Navy that many men and women have given their lives for. Not on my watch. Not on my watch. I refuse to sit back and watch our country decline. Shouldn't we send people to Washington, D.C. that will serve us in the same manner as our men and women do overseas in uniform every single day? Can't we elect people that will put the country first? Let's break this cycle. Let's quit sending the same type of people to Washington, D.C., the bureaucrats, the people that go out there, they get elected, then they come back and they lobby. It's the same cycle over and over again. We need people with proven leadership. And I hope you'll look further into my record. Not just leadership in the Navy and serving and putting the country first, but as a state treasurer who kept his promises to you when you trusted me with your vote, who's cut budgets, brought transparency, as an entrepreneur who actually understands how to get the economy going and understands the financial world and what's holding us back as a nation. I believe our best days are in front of us. I've traveled this big, beautiful state almost a year straight now. And I know Nebraskans believe that this country can get back on track, but we don't have much time. Our biggest threat isn't a foreign enemy. It's our internal spending problem that we have here in Nebraska. I'm sorry, in America. We need the same common sense that we have in Nebraska to move forward. I'd ask you to get on my website, ShaneOsborn.com. Follow me on Facebook or Twitter. And we've got a whole army of volunteers out there every single day. Thank you.
Final closing remarks from Sid.
I've been a community banker serving Nebraskans for 37 years across our great state, still involved in agriculture. My wife and I have been extremely involved in the nonprofit world, too.
I am a husband, a father, a grandfather, soon to be another grandfather. Is that the right way to say that? A fourth grandchild. But I fear for the future of our country because of the overreach of the federal government. I want to go back to Washington, D.C. as your senator, a Nebraska senator. Nebraskans are supporting my campaign. A majority of my support comes from Nebraska. And I don't want to be beholden to any Washington groups, any Washington PACs. I want to be beholden to you. I want to take Nebraska back to Washington, D.C. and cut back on the amount of Washington that comes to Nebraska. I would sure appreciate your support, your vote, sidforsenate.com. Thank you all for coming very much.
Bart McLeay, Sid Dinsdale, Ben Sasse, Shane Osborn, thank you all for being here. Let's give them a round of applause. Candidates to head over to a media room briefly for a few interviews, and then they'll come back in here into the room and be able to shake all of your hands. Also, thanks to Joe Jordan from Nebraska Watchdog and Jim from KFAB Radio. Thank you to all of you who have been watching online at KETV.com and to the UNO Thompson Alumni Center. Thanks so much.